This is a special presentation of AreaCable.com and the Area Guides Network, produced by CraigShipp.com with special guests from around the globe. I'm Peter McDermott, and now on to our feature presentation.
Okay, Monica, you've got something really fun going on tonight. Why don't you let us know what we're doing?
Hi, everyone. We're recording this on the 16th of January in 2012, and that is also Martin Luther King Jr. Day. So I wanted to have a hangout and have some real meaningful discussion to talk about discrimination and also the principles of protest and nonviolence that Martin Luther King Jr. exemplified so well in his protest movement. And I thought that we could open this up to some comments and discussion specifically about his letter from a Birmingham jail. And I will be reading some quotes from that specifically, and I hope that we can all have some discussion about some of our experiences. And I do want to add one small disclaimer. The letter from a Birmingham jail by Martin Luther King Jr. is meant for a religious audience, and it is addressed specifically to people of the Christian faith. But I want to say that we are not going to be addressing religion or lack of religion in this discussion. I am going to assume that ethics are able to be independent of religion, although I also respect everyone's right to embrace a religion if you so choose. I just feel that this is not a religious debate. This is a discussion of the principles of nonviolence as a protest means. So, nonviolence is a concept that's found in all religions. It's also embraced by some atheists. And I'll start off with a quote that says, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." And I will ask an open question, and anyone can respond. How have you experienced injustice or discrimination in your life, and how did it make you feel?
Hi, my name is Daryl, and let me start.
Okay,
go for okay. I was raised in a farm community, and I went to a predominantly white school all of my life. And in elementary school, I was probably one of maybe six African-American kids. And there was an incident that occurred perhaps in fifth grade. And up until then, I was a voracious reader, but up until then, I'd probably read maybe the Henry Higgins series and maybe the Bible or something like that. But I remember I was walking into the girls' bathroom in elementary school, and a little girl came in behind me, a Caucasian girl, pushed me, and my forehead hit the brick wall. And simultaneously, she said the N-word. And I remember standing there crying, and I remember it hurt really bad. And not the word, my forehead. And I remember thinking to myself, I don't know what the word means, but I went home and I looked it up in the dictionary. And I thought, oh, I see. And so that changed my whole reading agenda. And I started going to the library and reading about what my first book was, The Negro Revolution. And I read a lot of Richard Wright's stuff, and just to get an understanding of what the black community actually went through, because I wasn't experiencing the inner city prejudice, but there was prejudice in the area, obviously in the area where I grew up. So that changed my view, and I remember thinking, well, there's a lot of hurtful things and a lot of mean people in the world. So that was my start in my introduction into prejudice.
That seems like a very powerful experience, and one that would definitely carry over to many of your other experiences in life. Does anyone else have an experience that, you know, like, it doesn't have to have happened to you, you kind of witnessed it?
I'd like to share something.
Okay, go right ahead.
I'm obviously not African American, black, or whatever you want to, refer to it as, but I am Jewish. And where I come from, not that Jews are looked down upon, but they do have this, connotation of being, I guess, sneaky and, the basic stereotypes that, come along with being what you are. You see what I'm saying? And the school that I went to, it's in the city of Philadelphia. I don't know if anybody's familiar with the city. And there's a lot of, non-Jews. Basically, I was the only one, Jew in my graduating class. And then, I was bullied and stuff like that. High school's over now, so there's a life beyond that, but still kind of sucks, you know what I'm saying?
Right. There are definite racial prejudices and religious prejudices against the Jewish people. I mean, the history of World War II alone shows us that.
Right. Yeah.
I'm curious, Daryl Lynn, I'm curious as to how that event and or other similar events, if there are any, how they shaped you, if there are things you want to say about that.
Okay. Well, prior to that, my parents, and I get asked this a lot because I was raised on a dairy farm and my parents were farmers. My parents were African American. And prior to that experience, they had given me a lot of exposure to most of their friends who were Caucasian. And I, to this day, share relationships with the kids that I grew up with that my parents introduced me to. And we refer to ourselves, and they are Caucasian, and I refer to them as my sister, her as my sister. I still have a lot of relationships. I went on to marry a Caucasian. I am currently married to an African American. I find myself. There was a period in my life after that, though, that I tried to embrace the African American movement and be part of the whole attitude of, we've got rights because they're treating us poorly. And I had to sit down and say to myself one day that, there are a lot of Caucasians out there that I just truly love, that have been part of my life for so long that I cannot deny that relationship. So, yes, that one incident opened my eyes. Let's put it like that. It opened my eyes to what was going on in society, because I was pretty much sheltered. But in the long run, it hasn't changed. It helped me to probably develop myself into a much more well-rounded individual, someone who is able to, someone who has a daughter who's half African American and who's half Caucasian, someone who is quite comfortable going into African American communities and speaking, and has spoken on Capitol Hill and has prime in many forums. I find myself the only African American in a white setting, so I'm quite comfortable everywhere I go. I went through some things to work through to get to this point, but I'm quite comfortable with all colors.
So okay, I
have a burning question, and then I know I've said a lot here or asked you to, but I have a really burning question, which is where you stand on things like affirmative action, I'll just stop there.
Okay. Well, I've said this before out loud, and I'll say it again. I'm not a huge fan of affirmative action. I think that people, individuals need first of all, we in America, we need to realize that we are in a situation where education is free in terms of the elementary school, and you go to college, and you can get a good college education without having a lot of money, and there's no white guy that's going to hold you back. You can only hold back yourself by your attitude. So I can honestly say that I've been executive of this and executive of that, blah, 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 and I've gotten those opportunities because I'm articulate, I'm well-read, I guess you could say I know how to schmooze or whatever, but I don't do a lot of that. But I know what I'm talking about when I do speak. I don't speak a lot, but I just know what to do.
So, Scott, I'd like to answer your question. I do support affirmative action, but I think that basically the concept of affirmative action should change. I feel that what we're facing now in our society politically is different than what we faced in the past, and I think that the nature of discrimination is evolving as we see basically large corporations evolving. We see, unfortunately, corporations are in charge of the prison industry in many states now. They use it to turn a profit, and because of that, the more prisoners that are incarcerated, the more money they make. That gives them incentive to underfund the educational system. Unfortunately, many of the victims of an underfunded public education system tend to be minorities. They tend to be blacks, they tend to be Hispanics. That's the majority in America, and that is what you're seeing happen to the demographics of the prison population. So I'm not sure that our concept of affirmative action is the correct answer, but we are getting far, far ahead of where I had wanted to go. I'd wanted to talk some more about these quotes and basically right now I wanted to ask, do you believe that we're making progress with discrimination? In the 1960s, we fought for equal rights for black Americans. And now, do you feel that we have a lower class in the United States? And if we do, what do you feel that it is?
Who's your question for?
My question is for anyone. Anyone can feel free to answer.
I like to think that we have moved a long way, and that we're continuing to move along in that direction of, I don't want to call it equality, because I don't believe in equality as far as that everybody's equal. But I would say blindness to race, gender, sexuality, all that stuff. And with regard to big corporations and discrimination from corporations, from governments, from individuals, whatever, I like to think that with the internet being probably the largest factor, that it's much harder for a corporation, for example, to discriminate, because people will hear about it. I mean, if you don't get hired at some corporation because you're gay or because you're black or whatever, people are going to hear about it. Thousands, millions, whatever. I mean, it's going to spread fast. I think we're seeing that. We're seeing that with like the SOPA Act, and suddenly everybody's talking about it, and then the White House chimes in, oh, yeah, we're against SOPA.
That does raise a really important issue, that discrimination nowadays, you know, doesn't fall only on racial lines. It can also fall on, you know, it can fall on gender lines, it can fall on, you know, we need to achieve equality in terms of gays, bisexuals, lesbians, and transgender persons. In my state, Colorado, I have witnessed an act of discrimination, personally, taking place against a Hispanic person. And the act of discrimination that I witnessed took place at the post office. And it was a woman that spoke only Spanish, basically being refused to be helped by the clerks. I ended up trying to translate because I speak Spanish, although I'm not Hispanic. And after I ended up basically performing this free service for the Postal Service, which is a government entity, they told me to go to the back of the line, the clerk that was serving me. I did not even get to take my turn because the clerk assumed that I was Hispanic. And it really, that experience gave me a real window into the mind of, you know, what it must be like to be Hispanic in especially this state. I think Eastern America may not be such a pressing issue, but if you live in Arizona or Colorado or any place in the West, you know, Mexican Americans are extremely discriminated against. And that brings up something else I wanted to talk about. What do you think some of the obstacles are that we as a society face in trying to incorporate tolerance into our philosophy? What are some of the difficulties?
Hi, my name is Mark. I'm from Southern California. I'd like to answer your question, Monica. Probably one of the things that almost everybody faces is an obstacle towards equality. In my opinion, it would probably be economic justice. Because, I mean, obviously it's been brought to everyone's attention, especially with the current Occupy movement, that the gap between the most wealthy and the least wealthy has just tremendously become an insurmountable obstacle for most people making less than $30,000 a year to attain or get over, if you will. And it's kind of ridiculous that it's gotten to be so bad. I mean, right before my eyes, I remember being a teenager. I'm 31 years old. I remember being a teenager and saying, oh yeah, my uncle makes, you know, $50,000 a year. He's doing pretty well. Because he had his own home and, you know, a couple, you know, family cars and all that stuff. And I was a teenager at that time. And between then and now, I think maybe it's been about 15 years. He only makes maybe, like, I think his salary has gone up to about maybe $80,000 a year, whereas the person directly above him at work, I think, is making $160,000, twice as much as he is. And I'm sure the person above them is making up to, you know, probably around $250,000 a year.
Well, that's a very valid point. When they've done studies, actually this study was just released in the past year, they found that the average American's income has not increased since 1971. Right, and that's based on factoring inflation and, you know, the cost of everything. Exactly. So basically, we haven't made any progress since that time, which is pretty shocking. I mean, it is an extremely difficult problem. I want to read a quote from Martin Luther King Jr.'s letter from the Birmingham jail. He said, in any nonviolent campaign, there are four basic steps. Collection of the facts to determine whether injustices exist. Negotiation, self-purification, and direct action. And my next question is, where do you believe that the Occupy movement / Arab Spring / Russian protest movement, you know, there are protest movements that are going on concurrently all over the world. Where do you believe that they are in the framework of those four steps? And I will post those into the chat because I realize they're rather complicated. The first one basically being collection of the facts, and the second one being negotiation. Does anyone have any thoughts on that?
What was the quote again? I'm sorry.
Well, Martin Luther King Jr. believed that there were four stages in a nonviolent campaign, and that the first one was collection of the facts to determine whether injustices exist, the second one being negotiation, the third one being self-purification, and the fourth one being direct action. So my question is, where do you believe that any of the Occupy movements or the Arab Spring or current protest movements is in the framework of these four steps. And also, another question to consider, do you believe that these movements are constructive or destructive?
Constructive.
I believe that probably the Occupy, the people that have that are joining in the Occupy movement have either completely overlooked the first three steps or disregarded them in some way or another, because it seems that they're going straight to direct action and they're not really collecting their thoughts and what their agenda might be.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I have to agree that if there's one criticism I have of these protest movements, it's, you know, it's not just the lack of organization, it's the fact that in the past, protesters have not just an agenda, but basically you protest during a specific time and then you go and you organize and you elect your leaders, and then you come back and you protest again. Protesting strongly is not just about how long you can camp out, although I understand that is a symbolic gesture. But incorporation of these other elements is extremely important. And another question to consider is, what makes a protest movement either constructive or destructive? What factor? What makes it build something? And what makes it disintegrate something?
I guess I'll go ahead and say a couple things. And this is mostly just what I feel about the Occupy movement. So forgive me if I'm not super organized here. I wish that all the energy being expended there would be expended instead or pointed inward. I see a lot of people, what I see as being victims or playing the victim role, shouting at the man or shouting at these corporations, the government, et cetera, and as you said, being very unorganized and unfocused. And what I would love to see is these people instead looking inside and at the ways they can improve themselves and, you know, taking some responsibility. And yeah, you know, things suck and maybe we've been taken advantage of or whatever, but what can I do right now to make myself more powerful, more responsible, and more compassionate, maybe, you know, and if each person were to do that, then that spreads. You know, it's like other people see that and it spreads. And you know, these corporations, these banks that they're bitching about, these governments, all that, they're all made up of people. So when we start with ourselves.
So true. That is exactly true. And that is, most people don't realize that is the deciding factor in so many protest movements, is the positivity or the negativity of your mentality. If you approach a system with the mentality that you will eventually overcome it, it doesn't matter how big it is, it doesn't matter how big the occupation is, eventually you will overcome it. I mean, you only have to look to Martin Luther King Jr. for that. I mean, you'll overcome it. You can also look at the examples of Gandhi. I felt like I should read a little bit of the philosophy of nonviolence from the Wikipedia article, but the fundamental concept of philosophical nonviolence is not to defeat the enemy, but to win them over and to create understanding between all. So basically, it's a discussion tactic, but it's also meant to increase, basically, positive energy. So, in the midst of the American Civil Rights Movement, there was also another movement called the Black Panthers. And I'll read a quote from a Black Panther member named George Jackson, who said, "The concept of nonviolence is a false ideal. It presupposes the existence of compassion and a sense of justice on the part of one's adversary. When the adversary has everything to lose and nothing to gain by exercising justice and compassion, his reaction can only be negative. And these are two opposing views. You have one extremely optimistic view held by Martin Luther King Jr., and you have one extremely pessimistic view held by the members of the Black Panther Party. And so I ask everyone in this room, which one do you believe is right?
Can I say something about that?
Sure, chime in.
This idea, okay, and one thing that I think is important that the Black Panther guy said was, I don't know if you used the word opponent or enemy or something like that.
Adversary,
yeah. So what I believe is that there is no enemy. You know, it's like we can subscribe. It's our choice to subscribe to the enemy mentality, that we can be like, oh, yeah, they're an enemy, and we're going to fight them and blah, blah. Or we can be like, wow, so that person's really pissed off because they had a need for blah, blah, blah that wasn't met. They had a need for respect that wasn't met, whatever. We can choose to see everybody as just another human, and they have their issues just like we do. And that's where compassion comes from, I think.
I think that's extremely true. Does anyone else have any thoughts on this?
Yeah, I do have some thoughts. One of the books that I didn't mention when I first spoke was that I read a lot about the Black Panthers, because there was a huge uprising in the 60s, affected the Cleveland area, affected the nation. If you've actually studied what the Black Panthers were really initially about, it was about peace, it was about education. They were a well-informed group of individuals who understood the law and understood their rights. You won't find a lot of documents indicating that, but it is out there. I read George Jackson's book. I know about his brother Jonathan. I know about the imprisonment. I know what he says too. But the Black Panthers, unfortunately, have gotten, through history, have gotten the negative end of the portrayal of their stand in America.
Well, and they, and Darlin, please understand that I am not trying to imply that this is a negative viewpoint. I believe this is a very valid viewpoint,
okay.
And I believe that this is one that is being currently embraced by a large section of the Occupy movement, and I think that it's important to address. I'm not trying to say that this is the wrong mentality. I'm trying to open this up for discussion.
Okay, yeah, and I just wanted to say that because when I heard that, it all of a sudden it sounded like it's the media spin that
It's very true that white America found the concept of the Black Panthers extremely threatening.
Sure.
I mean,
yes,
any group of Black Americans that feels that they want to fight back, they will of course see as a threat, and there does still exist prejudice that is racial. And so I'm not trying to say
I'm not saying
that George Jackson's viewpoint is completely validated, but I'm trying to frame the two viewpoints, you know, opposing each other, because they are very much, if one is true, then the other is incorrect. If you can win the war with love, then you don't need to win the war with hate.
But I'll tell you this, and I didn't say it before. I learned more from reading about the Panthers than I learned from watching Martin Luther King. And what I learned was reading and education and arming yourself with knowledge was a powerful thing. And I've taught my children that, and it's benefited their lives. You know, I have a daughter at Northwestern who's getting her doctorate degree, and I didn't give them money to go to school. I told them to educate yourself, learn how to be articulate, learn how to write an essay. If you can write an essay and you get good grades, you can put yourself through college. Ergo, one has a scholarship from the National Science Foundation. So I learned from the Black Panthers that if you educate yourself, then you can get through this world.
Yes, and definitely education is a very important message, and it's something that the Occupy movement and the Arab Spring and any uprising needs to take to heart. But I also want to read a quote, another quote from letter from Birmingham Jail about conflict and tension. And when Martin Luther King Jr. addresses it in this letter, he says, "I must confess that I am not afraid of the word tension. I have earnestly opposed violent tension, but there is a type of constructive, nonviolent tension which is necessary for growth. Just as Socrates felt it was necessary to create a tension in the mind so that individuals could rise from the bondage of myths and half-truths to the unfettered realm of creative analysis and objective appraisal, we must see the need for nonviolent gadflies to create the kind of tension in society that will help men rise from the dark depths of prejudice and racism to the majestic heights of understanding." So, when we're talking about tension, I think we've all been through a pretty tense year. I mean, just judging from the videos that I have seen personally about Occupy Wall Street and just many of the protests in Europe and in many different places in the world, some of them have been, you know, they've blown my mind. My question is, what do you believe that this kind of thing can accomplish? Is this only just a way to get people's attention to the larger problem, or can it actually help solve the problem?
You lost me. I'm curious, what will solve or not solve the problem?
Well, the Occupy movement is taking a very particular tactic. And that tactic is to camp out in a particular space and to say, hey, there's a big problem, we're holding signs and we're going to draw the attention to this problem. And that is creating tension, which is what Martin Luther King Jr. addresses in this quote that I've read. And my question is, what purpose does this serve? Does it just serve to get Americans aware to this problem and the wider world aware that this problem exists? Or can it actually help solve the problem?
I think it's probably best used as a way for people to get their minds on the subject at hand rather than whatever else you said. Because, I mean, people for the most part, well, I think probably mostly Americans, and I do kind of get this idea from a Noam Chomsky book that I'm currently reading. He called the masses the bewildered herd. And he basically just says that the majority of Americans or the majority of the population anywhere is basically just a bunch of idiots, and they're entertained and sidetracked by the stupidest, most trivial stuff. And I think
Eastern media?
Probably, yeah, probably. The whole Occupy thing is happening, and I think it's a good thing. It's a good way to get people's attention on the real matter, subjects that matter, and the things that really are affecting everybody's lives in this country and around the world. And I don't think that it necessarily has to be to any degree violent at all, because I don't believe in violence for anything except racist. Like, if I hear somebody being racist towards somebody, like, and if I feel that they're being genuinely racist towards someone, like, I'm able to identify if they're using racial terms or racial words or slurs, whatever you want to call them, in a joking way or if they're serious. I can kind of distinguish that. And I think most people can. But the thing that really bothers me is when people are totally serious about using those words in a hateful way. That is probably one of very, very, very few things that would make me want to incite violence against anybody. Because that's just something I will not ever stand for. I cannot stand racism. It makes me sick to my stomach.
So, when you say that you would use violence, do you feel that that would accomplish anything productive if you did?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. But I mean, it gets me to the point that I'm so frustrated and angry that someone would be so stupid as to use that in their defense or to hurt someone else, that it just, I don't see any use in being that stupid. But of course, there's also the point of view where why would anybody want to be violent? Which I understand, because I mean, you can't make two wrongs don't make a right, you know. And yes. I understand that me saying that I would resort to violence or go so far as to be violent towards someone for just that reason is kind of, you know, obviously the other edge of the double-edged sword. But that's just my personal belief. You know, if you're going to be stupid enough to, you know, use racism towards somebody in a serious manner that's not joking, or if you're not being obviously facetious about it, I mean, it's like, I mean, obviously it's like fighting fire with fire, but sometimes that's necessary, and sometimes it is effective in making a point. And if it deters that person from using a racial slur in a serious, hateful way again, then I think you've accomplished something.
Well, I think that's definitely an issue that I'm afraid that we are about to see develop. Because a lot of things that are unbalanced have not been rebalanced. And there are a lot of systems that are immensely unjust. And I really hope that many of these movements can stay peaceful. But I do know that it is extremely hard for a protest movement to stay so. And unfortunately, in a movement like this, there are usually individuals who want to see it get violent because they can manipulate a movement for their own means. Maybe for personal gain. So I just hope that anyone watching this will think about the consequences of a movement becoming nonviolent. I'd also like to talk about the consequences of breaking the law, which is also addressed in the letter from the Birmingham jail. The quote is, "One may well ask, how can you advocate breaking some laws and obeying others? The answer lies in the fact that there are two types of laws, just and unjust. I would be the first to advocate obeying just laws. One has not only a legal but a moral responsibility to obey just laws. Conversely, one has a moral responsibility to disobey unjust laws." And my question is, do you agree?
But there are two sets of laws, or multiple sets of laws, depending on how much money you have, your status, who you're connected to. So to say the people who follow the laws are usually the people that usually get oppressed, people that have less ability to get lawyers. So you try to follow the law because you don't want to get in trouble. If you notice, every day you read about somebody who's rich, gets away with some kind of crime, they got the right lawyer, the right setup. So to say that you have to follow the laws, I think it's wrong. I think that I believe in meeting violence. I live in an area where it's predominantly white. When I came and moved into this area, I came prepared for a fight. And I think when I moved in with that kind of attitude, people were like, my God, stay out of her way. And I had no problems. But if I came in like little orphan Annie, or trying to make friends with everybody, trying to be all nice and innocent, they would have eaten me alive. So I think that, you know, unfortunately, the society, how you present yourself, it sits a wall. So people either decide they're going to be friends with you, they have to get past that wall, or if they're going to come past that line, it's almost like putting a line in the sand and saying, come past here, and you're going to get what's coming to you. And so, you know, and I applaud this group for getting together and having the discussion on such an important day of the year. But I think we need to be realistic and realize the rules that are set are for various people. Some rules are set to keep people in line, and other rules are to make sure other people get away with whatever crimes they commit.
Well, Martin Luther King actually was stating in this quote that he advocated breaking the law when he felt that the law was unjust. when he felt that the law was discriminatory and when he felt that the law was in contradiction with basically natural law. And you can find this concept in a lot of philosophies and a lot of religions. It's generally acknowledged that there is a natural law which supersedes, you know, an unjust law. And my question is, how do you personally determine when a law is unjust?
Hi, Monica, I have an example of that, Michelle. I go back when I was a kid. Back then, in the school in Italy, the teachers were allowed to they could slap you in the face or if you did something wrong, and that was very terrible. I'm talking about 45 years ago now. So as a kid, one time it happened to me. I was about 8 or 9, and my teacher, elementary school teacher, started to slap me on the face for no reason. And I reacted to that. My reaction was very violent, I would say, because I attacked her. And I think I was the first kid ever in the Italian school to attack a teacher at 8 years old. What I'm going to say with this is that that's a very clear example of an injustice, a law that is not just, which you have to react no matter what. That could be applied also, for example, here in Italy, to certain injustices that we are seeing now, as the politicians in Italy are making $16,000 a month, as opposed to somebody working in a factory who's making 8-9 euros a month. And now they come and tell us that we have to be more, they have to sacrifice ourselves and everything, while they're not willing to give up their very rich income. So that creates a tension socially. Also, here in Italy, we are seeing a lot of tension, racial tension, due to the fact that a lot of people, immigrants, are coming from Africa and from the Eastern European countries, try to make better living here. And the social issues, social differences have created a tension between the poor people who are trying to get some work to get a better life for themselves and their children. But what we are experimenting in is we see a lot of new people coming in, and they are being hated because they are perceived as people who are taking our job away from us. That is not, of course, my perception, but as a society, I'm seeing a lot of tensions with the Italian. Some of the Italian, of course, not all of them, have grown very, very strong racial issues against people who are immigrating to this country. So that's it. Of a law or something that has not to be taken as a law, and if it is a law, it should not be taken in consideration. The fact that they don't allow people to come in this country to seek a better life.
I think that's very true, and thank you for speaking up about that. That's also a pressing issue in America. I know it is in the UK as well. I think it is in many different places. In America, we are seeing that with Mexicans and with people who come from Central America to seek a better life. there's really no clear path for immigration for them, and the life that they live here is extremely difficult. They face a lot of discrimination and violence and quite a lot of horrible things.
Regarding what Martin, what your question with regard to like what laws do we ignore, which laws do we decide are just or not just? I think this is an argument. I think that it's a very ambiguous issue, and it's that everybody is going to decide in a different place on that. Like I might decide, well, it's okay for me to speed at certain times when there's no other cars around, or to run a stop sign, or smoke pot, or whatever. I think that everybody is going to have a different idea of what is just and unjust. So it's a really hard question, and I think the only way to answer it to me, and I know I'm biased here, I'm going to reveal that bias right now, but I think it's an argument for removing as many laws as possible and going back to the basics of no murder, no fraud, and no stealing. And I think any time we move away from that and we start piling on more laws, those new ones that are moving away from that are going to favor some group over some other group because of their ambiguity. And it's like, I don't think we need a special law to say, don't murder kids, because we've already got a law that says don't murder. So why do we need to favor some certain group and pile on more bureaucracy for something like that?
That's a very good question. And I personally think that when it comes down to it, it basically is up to each individual to have their own morality and to basically be their own policeman. Because we cannot enforce every single thing. We cannot look at every single action. And so it's going to come down to each one of us in the end. And since it was brought up in the chat, I will mention the National Defense Authorization Act, which is unconstitutional and which is completely unjust. We should not be authorizing people being held without trial. However, as I said in the chat, I feel that this is such a big issue that maybe we should have a whole nother discussion about it, because although, you know, it is important and it is civil liberties related, this is meant to be more of a discussion about, you know, personal experiences with discrimination and with the system and with protest. So
I'd like to chime in real quick, and this kind of, I was originally going to chime in quite some time ago when we were talking about Occupy Wall Street a while back, and I just wanted to kind of point out that the whole problem with the Occupy Wall Street kind of protest movement has been playing itself out in the left sidebar in the chat. During this entire broadcast.
Yeah, I wish we could show it to you.
I don't know if that's going to show up on the video or not.
It won't.
But there's really been a distinct failure of both sides to communicate in this chat on the left, and I think that's the same thing that we're seeing in real life out on the streets. One side says something that the other side considers inflammatory or incorrect or off the wall or each side responds as it sees fit, but they're talking past each other and there's no meeting of the minds going on here. Quite some time ago, Monica read that quote from Martin Luther King saying that a protest movement needs to do four things, and Mark Antony brought up, and I think correctly, that Occupy Wall Street seems to have jumped to the fourth thing without doing the other three. The third step in that process was self-purification, and I think self-purification is the step at which you do what Scott was talking about earlier, which is where you examine yourself, you examine your own beliefs, and you educate yourself, and you kind of figure out what the other side thinks, try to put yourself in their shoes for a little bit, etc., before you move to direct action, but then you still need to go to direct action, I think, at some point, whatever you, however you define that. And I see that, again, both in the news that I'm reading these days and just played out here between the people in this chat room, that I think we're failing at that third step. A lot of us are failing at that third step because we're not really getting in the shoes of the people who are talking about things that we don't agree with.
Well, and this is ironic because I said at the start that I was not going to have this be a religious discussion, but unfortunately I have to throw it back to Jesus, because Jesus was one of the first that basically said, hey, the Old Testament has some crazy, crazy laws. I don't want you to judge people based on these crazy laws. You know, like, let he who's without sin cast the first stone. And I'm an atheist here, so while I'm quoting Jesus, I want you to keep this in mind, because I respect the man and I respect his philosophy, and I feel that he was the inspiration for many of these belief systems, and there's a lot to take from that. And so I think that even though Martin Luther King Jr.'s letter is about religion, and some elements of religion are probably involved in many protest movements, I think that it's really about a meeting of the minds, and that talking and self-reflecting is an important part of any protest movement, or any education in general. Even if you're just going to educate yourself without, you know, meeting with anyone else, you have to reflect back on what you've learned and think about it. And so we are actually nearing the end of our discussion. I want to, the last few things I want to talk about are, I want to end with a quote, and then I want to get some reaction on that. And the quote is, "Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter." And that is also from Martin Luther King Jr.
I actually posted that earlier. I posted that quote earlier today, and I completely believe that. I wouldn't have posted it if I don't. And touching on what you just mentioned, Monica, as a fellow atheist, I love Jesus. He changed the world. He stood for good, good for justice for everyone. He stood for everyone having whatever they need to get along in life. And it just seems that so many of the political philosophies that are supposedly based upon that have lost touch with that altogether.
Yep.
And I think one of the last great men to follow Jesus' words to the almost pretty much to the T would definitely have to have been Martin Luther King Jr.
That's very true. And it's there's a great quote from Gandhi that I'd like to bring in as well. And he said, "I like your Christ, but I don't like your Christians. They are so unlike your Christ." And I'm sorry, I'm paraphrasing. I probably got one or two words slightly wrong, but that's the essence of the quote, and it's true. If you are a Christian, you know, you should basically embrace those same values. And so anyway, I want to end this discussion on a note of optimism. I believe strongly that we have, as a society, have an ability to see beyond race and to see beyond gender and to see beyond sexual orientation or disability. I say this as a person who uses a wheelchair, and it's hard for me. You know, like, I see how people see me in the wheelchair and how it changes their perspective. But I have faith that we can get beyond that if we educate ourselves and if we think about it, and what's more, if we talk about it, which is what we're doing. So thanks, everybody, for participating. I really appreciate it. And
yeah, absolutely. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having this forum.
Thanks, Craig, for recording.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I love this kind of talk.
We should do another one sometime. We kind of have a tradition before we stop a recording and give everybody a chance to say anything they want to say, if they want to plug a website or give contact information. We can kind of start up at the top. Is it Darylene?
Yeah. Yes.
Did you have anything you wanted to say before we end the recording?
No, I just wanted to say thank you to Monica for holding this forum. It's been very interesting.
Well, thank you all for participating.
Thank you.
Great. And Hanno? Maybe not. And Monica?
No, I just wanted to say thanks for participating. We'll probably do this again sometime. We may focus on other issues because I saw it was requested in chat that we focus on the National Defense Authorization Act and some other issues. So maybe we'll see you again sometime soon.
Sounds good. Mark Anthony?
I just wanted to say a couple things. First of all, thanks to Monica and you, Craig, for hosting this. This has been a great discussion. I love discussions like this that have... some meaning as opposed to discussions about trivial BS that is meant to keep us busy and not distracted from the issues that really matter, which is what we discussed here. I just wanted to share one thing that I try to live my life by. It's stay positive, love your life, love all, hate none.
Thumbs up.
That's good advice. Ron?
Okay. I'm not sure if Ron has a microphone.
Okay, Scott, Ron says he does not. Okay, Scott.
Yeah, I just want to thank you for the deeper conversation. I really enjoy the topic, and I'm a huge proponent for nonviolent communication. It's what I spend 80% of my free time pushing, or teaching, or whatever you want to call it. So I encourage all of you to investigate nonviolent communication. There's a book, and there's a lot of talk out there on the web about it. And visit my website, clearsay.net, where I make animations that show people getting into the typical conflicts that a couple or a boss and an employee or whatever. The typical conflicts people get in day to day. It shows you a third way besides attack and defense, another way of dealing with conflict.
Very good. And Pyle?
Yes, as everybody else, I want to thank everybody participating in this discussion. I believe that violence should stop, especially around us, not far from us. We should try to do something in our small society, in our village, in our homes, and then spread the news, try to get along together with fighting, because fighting doesn't get anybody anywhere.
Okay, very good. And thanks, everybody, for participating. I'm Craig Shipp. My website is CraigShipp.com. And, yes, anybody that has any suggestions for interesting topics, interesting shows that they want to have recorded, feel free to contact me, and I'll do the best I can.
I have one question. What YouTube profile will this video be available under?
Well, it'll be uploaded to my account.
It'll be uploaded to my account,
and we'll share it here on Google Plus. So you'll see Monica will share it. It'll probably be up tomorrow, and we'll share it first, like around noon or before, and then trying to share it throughout the day and try to get some momentum on it. Alrighty.
Try to get some more commentary and some more discussion going.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.